We're so glad to have all of you join us back live. We're excited about what the Holy Spirit's doing here. We wish you guys were all joining us here live in person, but we're so glad that you can be with us. I asked my spiritual son, Art Fernandez, to come forward and give a testimony of what the Lord showed him at the rejection and things that his mother went through. So we're inviting him up to give his testimony. Come on up, Art Fernandez. This is actually now an assistant pastor with Without Spot or Wrinkle Ministries International.
So I'm going to say my testimony. Some of you have actually heard it. And as Dr. Patricia was basically talking about, and I believe you were saying, Lucy, you were saying different women were basically saying what the baby feels in Dr. Patricia. And then I believe late in the back said something about chemically. Well, I'll share my story. I wasn't prepared to speak. and I'm a planner. So,
the Holy Spirit will lead you.
Amen.
Thank you for that.
Speak it out, brother.
So, I grew up in a very dysfunctional family. I have three brothers, two older brothers, one sister. I'm a Texan. I was born in El Paso, Texas. And we grew up in Los Angeles. But growing up, I always wondered, why was I born in LA? Why was I born in El Paso? We have family there, but we live in California. I always questioned that as a kid. Well, my mom and dad were always struggling for money, always fighting for money, always fighting about the bills, not getting paid. And my dad was a womanizer. I just found out maybe about 2-3 years ago that I have a half-sibling sister that she was doing, what's that called?
DNA.
And all of a sudden there's a match. And this girl is, my heart breaks for her, because she was just trying to find out if she had any brothers and sisters. Well, apparently she's just a couple months from my older brother. So, when my mom was, of course, the firstborn was planned. They rejoiced over him. All of a sudden, she's pregnant a year later from my other brother, and she has two boys. So now I'm coming, and they're arguing. He's getting drunk. He was an expiring singer, mariachi. So along with that, being in the entertainment industry, comes the women. So he would come home with lipstick, drunk, and they would argue. My mom felt rejected from my dad. And when she was pregnant from me, over the conversations, she didn't want to be pregnant. She didn't want to have another baby, but she was already saying, I can't even raise these two. How am I going to raise another one? How am I going to raise another one? So I believe someone said, I can't remember who said, the baby's feels the rejection. Well, when I was born in El Paso, my dad came to see me. Everyone told me that as soon as my dad held me, I started screaming, yelling, and my dad The Spanish told me, "Oh, you stupid kid, you crybaby." So I felt the rejection even more. But as a baby, an embryo, a fetus, I already felt the rejection from my dad. I already felt my dad not wanting me.
Yeah.
Not to cry. I already felt my dad not wanting. I already felt like I didn't belong. I really felt like I didn't belong. And I grew up and my dad would always call me. I'm gonna go ahead and say it, I'll probably get in trouble. Pendejo, which is basically stupid. And that was my nickname. That was my name. So I was called stupid, you're worthless. You're worthless, you'll never amount to anything. So I'm going to school, and at that time, if you were off track, you were reading, they would make us read a paragraph each, and I would start sweating because I'm like, oh my god, they didn't make me read. I'm gonna lose my space. She's gonna call me stupid. She's gonna say, so all of a sudden the teacher's putting me on blast in front of the whole class. So the first reminder that came to me is, it's true. I am stupid. I'll never amount to anything. So trying to learn in school, you can just imagine, it was so difficult. Yeah. It was, I literally felt I was stupid. I really felt like, why was I born? My mom should have just had an abortion. My mom would actually make me feel, you can't make a decision on your own. So she would literally make me feel like I was stupid. You got to go to your older brother. You got to go to your sister to make a decision. And when you grow up that way, you start feeling, well, obviously, I must be special needs. And trying to learn in school, the worst thing that they could do, I'm sorry if I'm insulting anyone that's a teacher, but they put you in all of a sudden a special program that literally makes you feel like you're stupid.
Yeah.
So they put me in a special class for kids that aren't keeping up to speed. So I said, and all of a sudden you're being teased from the other kids. Oh, these kids are stupid, they're special needs. They come to school in the little yellow bus. So, not only was I bullied, I was teased, and coming home with the report card, I didn't know how to read it, so I gave it to my mom and dad. I got my butt whooped. I got my butt whooped because I thought talking in class, not listening, getting up. Of course, you're not. I couldn't stay still, and I felt so rejected. I felt I couldn't have friends. I believe Dr. Patricia mentioned you push everybody away, and that's exactly what I was doing. I didn't want people to get close to me. I didn't want people to get close to me to know how bad I was. So it came to the point where now I'm questioning things. Why is this happening? Why does my dad hate me? And my mom, bless her heart, she was trying to do her best But she was overprotected, which enabled me, which made me feel like I can't do it. And I think that's the worst thing you could do to somebody, because now I felt like I can't do it on my own. Well, I was in junior high. And I think when you grow up in that way, you start rebelling. You start questioning things. And I started getting really angry. I was angry at God. I was angry at my mom and dad. I hated my dad. I hated my dad for the words he said. Actually, every occasion got worse. Every occasion, not only did it get verbal, it got to the point where I was playing on the bed with my other siblings, and of course you're jumping on the bed or you're doing donuts as a kid, and he got my feet, I just threw them against the wall. And I probably was like 7 or 8 years old. Not that it hurt it so bad, but I felt like, man, this guy's my dad, and he's doing that to me? Your dad's supposed to protect you. So I started getting angry, and I was like, man, when I grow up, I'm never gonna be like him. Well, guess what? That's exactly what I was becoming. I hated the man so. I hated the man so much, I was becoming what I hated. I mean, probably 15, 16 years old. And growing up in East LA, you're around the environment, and I believe that a lot of kids start drinking because of the dysfunction in their house. Now I know that. And I was walking down the hallway. There's a long hallway at my mom's house. And I was walking down the hallway, and he bumped my shoulder, like punking me. And he told me, hit me. Hit me. Go ahead, hit me. And I started crying. And I told him, you're my father. And my mom came in between both of us. And she told me, don't hit him. Don't hit him. And she, you know, they started lashing out at each other. And for you parents, that's the worst thing you could do, because your kids are looking at you. And I told them, I wasn't going to hit them, because I knew that would have changed my life completely. But I told them, you're my father. You're supposed to protect me. And I told them, you know what? I'll never be a man like you. I'll be better than you. So my mom and dad got a divorce. And when they got a divorce, I was like, man, I'm free. I'm free. He's out of the house. Well, I went wild. I went wild because I was in high school already, and I started drinking at 10th grade. And it wasn't just drinking. It was drinking to get drunk. And I didn't know why I wanted to drink. I just wanted to kill the pain that I felt inside. And got out of high school, started hanging around with club promoters, And along with that comes girls, comes drinking. I started doing coke. And when I did coke, of course they give it to you for free the first time. And man, it was great. And the enemy really lies to you. He lied to me like, man, wasn't that great? It made you feel you could accomplish, and absolutely, I'm not gonna lie to you. It made me feel like I could accomplish anything. It made me feel like I could touch the stars. It made me feel like everything my dad told me was the opposite. It made me feel like I could accomplish anything I was going to accomplish. Well, I was hooked. I was hooked. And I'm buying it. I'm spending all my money on it. I'm never home. Of course, my mom knew that I was what I was doing. She never stopped praying. I would actually get so angry when I would get home because I grew up in a Christian home, but I was always questioning God. Where was God when my dad was doing that to me? Where was God then? Why didn't God do anything? So when I would see my mom on her knees praying, I'd be like, I felt a sense of guilt. I felt guilty because, man, you're over here doing drugs, getting drunk, and look at her. But she never gave up praying for me. Well, one time, we were planning a New Year's party, and I just did too much. And I drove home. This is how dysfunctional I was. Had a suspended license, had warrants. Sorry, River Bend. Not one, probably five warrants for suspended license. And I was still driving a car with a no registration, expired tags. What was I thinking? And drunk and under the influence. And I was like, God, protect me. Just make me make it home. You know, God never left me. I left him.
Amen.
I left him based on my decisions, based on my choices. I left him. I made it home. I made it home, and I started freaking out. It was dark. I'll explain it to you the best I can. My body wanted to stop, but my mind didn't want to stop yet. It wanted to keep going. So I got to my bed, and my mind is still gone. And it's telling me to get up and run, and I'm like talking to myself, you gotta relax, you gotta relax. I said a very small prayer. I said, God, please don't let me die. I knew that if I die, where I would be. That's how stupid my choice was. I'm sorry, I just get a little passionate about that. That's how irresponsible my choice was. My choice was, I was selfish and thinking about myself. And that's what the enemy does. He lied to me. You're gonna be okay. And of course, it lures you in when now you're hooked. Said a very small prayer. God, please don't let me die. I bargained with, I was bargaining with God. If you don't let me die, I will never do this again. You don't bargain with God. Well, guess what? God is so merciful. He didn't let me die. Woke up the next day with a huge hangover, feeling not good. Your body's craving it. Woke up at 5 in the afternoon. Of course, the worst thing you could do when someone's like that is give them the silent treatment. So I felt more rejected from my mom because my mom knew that I was doing that. But instead of asking, why are you doing that? What's leading you to that? She rejected me more. And she gave me the silent treatment. And she didn't talk to me. So I left. Now the guys that I was hanging around with, that I was doing that, of course, they were giving it to me. And the Holy Spirit was literally talking to me, remember your commitment. And I said, I can't do this. Sorry, guys, I can't do this. Now, my friends were my enemies. So I had to make a choice. Was I going to continue? If I was going to continue hanging around with the same guys, eventually I was going to do it. So I had to separate myself from them. And I did. I didn't talk to my dad for several years. And the one who kept in contact with my dad was my older brother. Now, I still continued to drink. I still continued. And my choice of drinking was never beer. It was just strong liquor. Strong liquor, because I just want, I used to say, I don't want to get waterlogged, I just want to get drunk.
Yeah.
Sorry. Someone agrees with me. I said, man, I don't want to get waterlogged. I just want to get, man, they didn't get all water. So I said, I'll drink shots or I'll just drink it straight. So my oldest brother would keep in contact with my dad. I started working at a men's store just to pass time. And my dad would come and see me, come and visit me. He was trying to make things right. And I would give him the silent treatment. I felt so much hatred towards my dad. And I used to tell my brother, dude, why does he come to see me, man? I have nothing to say to him. I felt like I moved on. I'm already healed. I forgave him. And he could go on. And he goes, just hear him out, man. You guys just spend time with him. Well, he wanted to go eat, so we would go eat. We would go eat an hour, 45 minutes. We wouldn't even talk to each other. Wow. That's how much hatred I had towards my dad. So happened several times. We would go eat. I think we probably went to go eat four or five times. Okay, see you later. Okay, take care. And I said, man, this is dumb. Why are we doing this? This is dumb. Why are we doing this? We're not. He would ask me, oh, so have you been? Oh, I've been good. I've been good. You know, it was just the small talk, but I would not let him in besides. And they didn't know my personal life, and they didn't know what's going on. I wanted nothing to do with him. I met my wife. And I know that God put her in my life for a purpose. When I met my wife, my dad fell in love with her. My mom didn't. My mother interviewed my wife when we actually were going out, when I said we were getting married. She freaked out because she had two kids. I'm sorry, because she wasn't pure. And you know what? To me, pure, impure, that really didn't matter.
Amen.
What mattered is that she had a good heart and she was going to serve God. Yeah. That's what mattered to me. And my dad fell in love with her. So every time we would go eat, I would take Mary. You guys talk. So it was a big mistake taking her, because then she tells me, how come you don't talk to your dad? And I go, because I'm eating. You don't talk to me when I'm eating. So I don't know how it happened. I guess God really wanted me to get it out. And I told her, you know, I told her little things, little bits and pieces, you know. It was just hard with my dad growing up. And she said, have you forgiven him? I go, yeah, I forgave him a long time ago. And I believe my spiritual mother said something. Forgiveness is big. And I did forgive my dad by saying it, but in my heart, I was still holding on to certain things. I was still holding on to him calling me stupid. I was still holding on to him telling me I was worthless. I was still holding on to him telling me I would never amount to anything. I was still holding on to that. I wanted to forgive him, but I felt like the pain was so big, I couldn't forgive him. And the only one that could help me do that was God. So Mary asked me, have you forgiven your dad? And I told her, yeah, I forgave him a long time ago. But I was still holding on to that. So eventually we are talking because of Mary. And I picked him up to go eat. And I told him, Dad, you know, I'm going to get married. He was all jazzed up. And he told me, take care of Mary. And I told him, Dad, and he met my kids, and he told me, take care of Alexis and Jasmine. And both of my mom and dad always wanted me to have our kids, and I didn't want our kids, Mary's kids, to feel any different as your favorite. And the reason I say that, because I grew up that way.
Yeah.
And I said, never going to do that. I don't want our kids to feel like you have favoritism or feel any different. So she wanted kids. My mom would say, so when are you guys having a baby? I go, we already have two. That's enough. When I told him that we were getting married, he was so excited. My dad had heart problems from a very young age. He had heart problems right after getting married. My dad got married at age 26. And I always said, well, why does my dad have heart problems? What's wrong with him? He had open heart surgery at age 30, 31, 32. And when he had open heart surgery, they moved some veins around, and that would happen in 1971. From 1971 to the day he passed, he must have had about 9 other surgeries of open heart surgery. After I told my dad we were getting married, I told him, okay, Dad, if you're going to show up, if you're going to be there, you need to wear this suit. He goes, whatever you want. I took him to go get measured. He wore a suit. He was so excited. Mary asked me to talk to my dad before we get married. So I told him, Dad, I just want you to know that I forgive you. And someone that feels the guilt that he felt, he just wanted to squash it right away and move on. And I go, Dad, just let me finish. I forgive you for the way you treated me. And I really went into detail because I believe that's what God wanted me to do. I forgive you for the words you told me. I forgive you for treating me the way you did. He starts telling me that his mom had him at age 12, 13. In Mexico. When she had him, she didn't want him. She didn't want him. He was raised by his grandmother and his aunt. He didn't see his mother till he was 17 years old. He was through his, I believe a kid gets his self-esteem from his father, and he's nourished during those years.
Yeah.
So he felt no nourishment from his mom. So my dad grew up angry. He grew up angry. He grew up from a very young age. I think he was 12, 13 years old. He started smoking and drinking already. So he goes, and now he meets his mom at 17. At 17, he goes and looks for his dad. He finds him, and his dad tells him, you're not my kid. Whoever told you were my kid, you stupid kid, get away from here. So he felt more rejected from his dad. At that point, my dad, I felt so much compassion towards my dad. I felt like none of that matters what happened. God just showed me, just embrace your dad. Just love him where he's at. Love him where he's at. My dad got married. I don't know why. He got married after with a lady from Mexico. We had 3 other kids. And I would pick him up to go eat. And waitress is passing by and he's checking out the waitress, and I'm like, okay. I'm like, my point is, he never changed. And God didn't want me to love him only if he changed.
Yeah.
God wanted me to love him where he's at.
Amen.
He couldn't love me because he didn't have any love. He didn't have love to give. Eventually, we're married. Got married. My dad was like a teenager at his prom. He was so excited. My mom was happy, unhappy. My mom was very controlling. Very controlling. And that was passed down to my other siblings. Very controlling, where she wanted to control everything and she wanted to make sure that everything was done a certain way, to the part where she interviewed my wife. And I had to tell her in a nice way, Mom, whether it's a mistake or not a mistake, it's my life. That's what I'm choosing. Well, I remember I told her that, and all of a sudden, unresolved issues surfaced up in our marriage. My wife, no disrespect to my wife, she's not organized, she's not a planner, she had no discipline, so I'm very disciplined, so I'm giving our kids chores, and she was like, what are you doing? She felt like I was breaking them. It's not that I was giving them chores, it's the way I was doing it. All of that started happening in our marriage. During my club years, not only was I drinking, I was going to strip clubs, sleeping around, and for men that think that's in the past, it's a demonic spirit. It's a demonic spirit that you gave a right to. This might sound funny to some of you guys, but those images are engraved in your brain. And the only way that you could wash them out is by God's Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
We're probably 2-3 months. As soon as we went to Cancun for our anniversary, as soon as we got off the plane, we're arguing. We didn't argue while we were dating. But all of a sudden, we're arguing. And Mary, if you guys know my wife, she all of a sudden, she feels conflict. She just basically shuts down. And we're moving into my condo. And I'm trying to have it all ready. The furniture's not there. And I'm getting upset. At that point, I used to get really angry. So I'm getting upset, calling them. You guys were supposed to have it there. I gave someone the key to have all our furniture there. So we're getting there, and no furniture is there. So that even makes things a little bit more tense. So coming in together in a blended family, both with baggage. My wife, her first husband passed away of cancer. And now my baggage is like two U-Hauls coming together. In my sleep, I was having images of all the pornography I allowed. And I'm sorry if I'm being too graphic. And I just felt so cheap. My wife would, wait a minute, we're married, you're not even touching me. I didn't even want to touch her. I felt like for men that do pornography or have done it, and they say, I wasn't cheating. You are cheating because you're intimate with that spirit.
Yeah.
And wake up and I would wake up angry. I didn't know why I was getting angry. We would start arguing. We would start arguing. The kids would get on my nerves. I would be so short with them. Just do what I told you. And that spirit, it's all of a sudden your wife's not doing anything right. I was putting her on diet pills because I didn't even know why I was doing that, because I wanted her to look like that image in my head. It got to the point, that spirit that I had allowed did not want to leave me. It had such a strong hold on me that before getting married, when we were already dating at my mom's house, it started there, but I ignored it. And I always said, wait a minute, I'm a Christian. I'm going to church. This shouldn't be happening. Well, there I was in bed, and I felt like literally someone's hands on my throat. And my mom said that she was trying to walk in the door, and she couldn't. I grew up in a church, Pentecostal church, and no one talks about demons. They always said, you accept Christ, you're good. You're good. That's all in the past. Well, it didn't surface anymore. We're married, and all of a sudden it's surfacing on our marriage, and it's surfacing when I'm asleep. I'm seeing those images. I'm seeing, I'm choking. I'm feeling like someone is literally choking me. And now that I really think about it, it was really trying to stop my voice. It was trying to silence me. My wife asked me, you were having a nightmare. What were you dreaming about? Are you kidding me? How could I tell her? Oh, I was thinking of this that I did 20 years ago. I was embarrassed. And I was embarrassed. I couldn't tell her. Well, you might think I'm perfect. Or I've never been to a strip club, but I have, and everything that I did in my past is now surfacing. I was so embarrassed to tell her that. Well, the anger, when you do pornography, there's a spirit of imperfection. There's a spirit of anger. And I believe that's why a lot of these men end up abusing the women and taking advantage of them and murdering them. It got to the point where we were just arguing and it just got so bad. It got to the point where I pushed her. And I was like, I didn't push her, I just tapped you. But I pushed her. And my wife, she took it like I hit her. I'm like, I didn't hit you, I pushed you, I just tapped you. You fell. And she said, I'm leaving. And, I always talked about divorce. And when you say the word divorce, that's the biggest mistake you could do. And I didn't want to divorce my wife. I just didn't know how to fix it. And I always said the word divorce because that's exactly what my mom and dad said. When they would argue, it wasn't, okay, we argued, and now we're coming together, we're okay. They would cuss each other out. They would say divorce. You leave. No one would leave till it happened. So I would use the word divorce. And eventually Mary left. But we couldn't even talk to each other. We couldn't communicate. We could only text. That's the only way we could actually communicate with each other is by texting. We've been married 19 years. 18 years.
20.
20 years. I wasn't counting the 2 years that we were separated. We were separated 2 years. We went to several counselors. And Mary was always walking in and she would be crying. And I'll be like, oh God, why are you crying? Let's just talk about how we're going to fix this. And she would start crying. I said, man, as soon as she starts crying, I'm done. I'm done. I've already lost. We went through maybe 5, 6, probably 8 different counselors. The last one that we had in Pasadena, and she got from the Christian radio station. She gets there early, and they start when I walk in. And so they always wanted to talk about conflict resolution. What was the argument during the week, or what was the last argument? What are you guys arguing about? And I always told Mary, do you really think that it's about what's happening or what happened before? I never studied this. So whatever Dr. Patricia's talking about, I never studied it, but I know that God was putting it in my heart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What you're going through is about your past.
Yeah.
Unresolved issues. And I always told my wife, what you don't deal with, we'll get dealt with one way or another.
Yeah.
And she would always say, no, you're too controlling. You want things done a certain way. Everything has to be done your way. I go, do you really think it's about the trash? Right. Or something that happened before? So one of the counselors that we went to, he started challenging me. He says, so what you're saying, it's your way or the highway. So I told him, yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. So then he tells me, you know what? You're right. You should get a divorce. I go, thank you. And I walked out. I walked out thinking, yeah, I proved him wrong. I got it my way. But I didn't want to divorce my wife. She would always text me, so are you going to file for divorce? As a man, she moved out. I was still paying for her apartment. I was still giving her money, not because she asked me, because I knew it was the right thing to do. And at first, her pride, she didn't want to take it. She tells me, I don't want your money. Because she thought if she takes my money, it's an attachment. I'm going to want something from you. And I go, no, I'm just want to make sure that you and the kids are okay. So she texts me and she tells me, are you going to file? Am I going to? Who's going to file? Let's just get this over with. I go, go ahead. I just didn't know how to fix it. Mary was working in the healthcare industry and she met this lady then knew Dr. Patricia. And Mary was crying at work. And she said, you know what? You got to go see Patty. At that time, she wasn't Dr. Patricia. You got to go see Patty. They send her a lot of the hard cases. A lot of the hopeless cases. So Mary texts me that there was, at that time, Dr. Patricia, they used to have a boot camp for marriage in Glendora, but it was every other week. I love to eat. And she tells me, you know, they're having a boot camp for marriage on Saturday, and they're having a potluck. Do you want to go? You know, when God has a plan,
amen,
God will get you there. One way or another. God knew that if there was food there, I was going to be there. God knew that. And I was a jerk. Because she tells me it's Saturday. And I told her, well, I'll let you know Saturday. So she texted me Friday. Are we going to go? And I go, I'll let you know Saturday. Not that my schedule was just so busy. I was just being a jerk. We said things to each other that you never should say. Vice versa, I said things to her, and she said things to me that I just said, I'll never forgive her. But sometimes you don't have to say the words. It's just how I treated her. I wasn't treating her the way I was supposed to treat her, the way God wants me to treat her. I'm not going to treat her only if she treats me this way. So I told her, okay, give me the address. She met me in front. And I gave her the drill. I told her, if you talk to anybody, if you tell anybody our dirt, I'll leave you here and I won't come back. She obeyed. She didn't say anything. And God had a plan from the start. Want to give God a good joke? Tell him your plans. Tell him your plans. You know, and I say that because I'm a planner, and I always plan. When I met my wife, so what are your plans for the future? She goes, plans? I'm just trying to get by. And I had my plans for the first 2 years, for the first 5 years, for the first 10 years. And told her, if you talk to anybody, if you tell anybody our dirt, I'll leave you here and I won't come back. God started working from that point. Not only in me, and my wife too. Because I told her that, she didn't say anything. We started dating. We started dating. From that point on, when you're obedient to what God's telling you, God starts working. Amen. Obedience is a big word. So they're having a potluck every other week. And every other week we're going. Finally, I think the second or third time we start dating, we're going to the movies, we go eat, and we meet this couple. Sometimes God puts people in your life for a purpose. And we met this couple because we were laughing. We were laughing, or instead we would be arguing or cussing each other out. As quiet as you see Mary, she used to get pretty angry. We met this couple that said, oh, so everybody, I felt comfortable around this, where I was at, because everybody had issues. So I said, okay, well, as long as I don't tell anybody my dirt, it's okay. So I felt like a safe environment. I wouldn't talk to the guys. I would just stay within my circle with Mary. I would stay away from Dr. Patricia. I didn't.
For sure.
I saw the way she prayed for people. And I said, man, I don't want her to get close to me because she'll know my dirt. So we met this couple, and he comes up, and his wife, he goes, so how long have you guys been married? Mary said, 2 years. And I said, yeah, but we're separated right now. Have you ever said something and you try to take back the words? I was like, oh, God. Then the first thing he said, oh, well, that shouldn't have happened. Then he asked, is it okay if we pray for you? And I said, yeah. I thought it was going to be them. Then he brings Dr. Patricia. When he brought her, I was like, I wanted to run. I literally wanted to run. But what I'm trying to say, it was that demonic spirit that still wanted to hold me in bondage where I was at and tell me, hey, if you tell anybody you're dirt, they're not gonna understand you. They're gonna judge you. So the first words out of Dr. Patricia's mouth where she said, is it okay if I pray for you? And I said, I'm the one that was answering. Mary wasn't saying anything. And I said, yes. And she prayed. I can't remember everything she said. She prayed for us. And she asked if we would be willing to come in for counseling. I said yes. And when I said yes, I'm trying to take back those words. I'm like, oh, God, I gotta say yes. So she set up the appointment for Monday, our intercessor. Elder Lucia was there, and she's a lot like me, and she greeted us. No, so let me back up. I called Mary, and I told her, you know what, I'm not going to make it. At that time, I worked way on the other side of the 405 freeway, which was towards Santa Monica. Dr. Patricia was in Glendora. I told her, it's going to take me over an hour. I'm not going to make it in time. Well, school session wasn't on, so there's no traffic. She tells me, well, I'm going to be there. If you want, I'll meet you there. I'm going to be there. There was no traffic. I made it there in probably 30 minutes. And when I made it there like probably 20 minutes before our appointment.
Oh, wow.
My point is, God wanted that to happen. God wanted to set me free. And the enemy wanted to keep me in bondage. He wanted to keep me in bondage by not letting anybody know my past. They're going to judge me. Dr. Patricia's first words were, tell me about your past. God. I couldn't stop crying. I look at Mary and I told her, that's exactly what I've been talking about. And she says, no, but you're too controlling. And I told her, that's exactly what I've been talking about. And I told Dr. Patricia, where do I start? And do we have a perfect marriage? No. But God is our hope. And every year we celebrate our anniversary. We've been married 20 years. And now we have two grandbabies. I remember Dr. Patricia saying, God, the enemy doesn't want your marriage, he wants your kids. If kids grew up in a dysfunctional, broken, divorced family, going after your kids, the kids are hurt. Our daughter's married to you, Dr. Patricia's grandson. If you would have told me that, it's like, there's no way. Before, my dad passed away 8 years ago. And the biggest satisfaction that I had is I forgave my dad.
Thank you, Jesus.
I forgave my dad. I would pick up my dad to go eat. I would pick up my dad to go eat, and we would actually talk. We would talk. Did he ever change? No. His kids from his other family, he still mistreated them, still talked to the girls, calling them every name in the book. And I would tell him, Dad, you can't do that. You can't do that. And once again, God was just reminding me, your job is not to change him. Your job is to love him where he's at. Was it easy? No, it was very hard. Before my dad passed away, as I made my peace with my dad, if you're holding someone in unforgiveness, the best thing I could tell you, forgive that person. My mom passed away in August. She was 86. And probably 10 years ago, prior, I asked her, Mom, I would like you to sit down with my dad and just talk. Oh my God, my mom got so angry. She goes, I have nothing to say to this, that man. I have nothing to say to him. And I told her, Mom, I'm not asking you to go back with him. I'm just asking you to talk. I go, how nice would it be you and him in the same room and us in the same room? And my mom was hurt. My mom was hurt that he cheated on her. My mom was hurt that he would come home with lipstick. And she held on to that pain where she couldn't forgive him. And I say that, my mom had dementia. But even having dementia, she was cussing him out.
Wow.
She wouldn't forget that he was lazy, that she would call him every name of the book. Mm. Why? Because she didn't forgive him. And right after I told my mom that, my oldest brother, that is very controlling, he calls and he tells me, stop telling our mom to talk to our dad. And I told him, the reason I'm saying that is just to make her peace. If she forgives him and they talk, it's not hurting her. It's not hurting her, it's healing her. When my mom started mentioning my dad after having dementia, my oldest brother goes, you know what? Maybe you had something there. God had a plan. And the biggest satisfaction that I have is that my dad, as he got older, he never told me, I love you, son. As he got older, and we made our peace with each other, and I forgave him, and just loved him where he's at. He was able to tell me, I love you.
Wow.
He would always ask for Mary, always ask for the kids. And I'm just grateful for this ministry. And you know, sometimes God puts people in our life for a purpose, as he put Mary with her co-worker and directed us to Dr. Patricia. Amen. But I pray that my testimony has blessed your heart.
Amen.
So we heard generational rejection and abandonment. Is my mic on?
Yep.
Yeah.
We heard rejection and abandonment at birth in the womb. We heard how the hurts and pains cause us to get into drugs and alcohol. We heard how in our marriage, the baggage we bring into that relationship has really a big impact. We're going to, because of time, I'm going to invite Mary to come forward because she has some other insights that I want her to share, some of her testimony, because it's really, really awesome too. So Mary, would you come on up? And you need the handheld mic, and come on up, and we're going to mic you up.
Mary, Mary. Hello, everyone. So, I was about to say RTMI.
Oh,
I don't mean that. All glory to the Lord.
Amen.
Yes. Because you know, the only way that people can really know the Lord's healing power, restoration power, is when we actually share the truth of what, you know, we've been through. Because if we pretend to be perfect, or, you know, we didn't go through any of this, you know, this is who we are today, then we truly don't advance the kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
So you, no need to go into our testimony on my end, because you pretty much heard all of the highlights of our marriage. The only thing I will, you know, add to this part is that when Dr. Patricia said, can you guys come in for counseling? And then she called us in individually. I thought, wow, this is my time to really blast my husband, right? I had a whole list of all the things he was doing. But you know, sometimes when you grow up so dysfunctional, you don't see that everything is about you. You don't get to see what's happening around you, because I believe you said it so well, sister, about, you know, when you have that orphan spirit or that victim mentality, you know, when you are lacking so much love, you start to be so self-centered.
Yeah.
And so it's your wounds. It's your hurt,
yeah.
Right? It's your pain. Not seeing or acknowledging all that my husband went through. And you know, he went through a lot. So anyway, when Dr. Patricia told me, well, let's talk about you. And I'm like, uh-oh. I always say this, deer caught in headlights. Okay, so she says, we're not going to mention art today. And I'm like, oh my goodness. What will we talk about today? I was so used to all the counselors wanting to hear all about my husband. And, you know, and it didn't feel like we really weren't getting anywhere, because it was just, to say some counselors are biased. You know, one of our counselors was truly biased. He saw me like a daughter. He then moved me out. When I left my husband, he came and packed me and moved me out.
Oh, wow.
And so, you know, they see the tears, and my emotions were real. But I think sometimes, you know, a lot of counselors are just not trained in this area of healing and deliverance, and let's go back to the root. So when Dr. Patricia said, well, why don't we talk about you, and let's go down your path, I had no idea. And she talked about it in the beginning, or I think today in the beginning, how we just learn to survive. And so when we learn to survive, when my husband had told me, so where do you see yourself 2 years, 5 years, 10 years? I'm like, I have no idea. You know, I'm a widow with two kids, and I'm just trying to make it. So I was in survival mode. I had to just survive. So I had to just survive. So when Dr. Patricia, you know, wanted to know about my past, it was just like opening up a lid, right? A lid of emotion, and then my temperament too. I'm a phlegmatic, right? Phlegmatic. And so pushing stuff down was just an art to me. I just knew how to do it. And I knew how to get up the next day. And I knew how to just work. I knew how to just get by. But one thing that the Lord has been revealing to me recently, and this is why Dr. Patricia, you know, she called me up. We've all started a journey, you know, when we became believers, of healing, right? It's all been a journey. And so our Lord God doesn't care how long our healing takes, as long as it happens.
Amen.
And sometimes we get a bit impatient. And so I wanted to just share with you that the Lord has been, over the last 20 years, so you know, since we met Dr. Patricia, 18 years, that it's been like a layer at a time, right? And then another layer. And then another, and then you're like, man, we're good, like we're in ministry, and we've been believers for all this time. You're done, right, Lord? you're done with my healing. And then something else happens. So this last quarter of this year, we've had a lot happening in our lives. You know, we lost Art's mom. And Art and I were both really sick back in October. And so we were very sick. And when you don't feel well physically, mentally, you're also not well. And so I had some downtime for about a month where I couldn't really pray. I couldn't really read the word because I was not feeling well. So I had to just hear the word. But here's the thing. I had to hear the word. I had to still feed my soul. Now, not feeding your soul, you really become even more weak. Weaker than I felt. So I started asking the Lord. When you start asking the Lord to go back and heal, and you have no idea that there's stuff still there, and when he brings it up to the surface, like Dr. Patricia talked about the pus pockets, right? And you think like, okay, I dealt with this one, I dealt with this one. But one thing that the Lord revealed to me, actually this week, so October to now, I've been asking the Lord a lot about how to stay healthy. And he's been showing me that PTSD, so I don't know if you guys are familiar with that term, it doesn't even have to be something so dramatic that's happened in your life. It could be small, could be big, but it's going to surface at some point in your life. And so for me, again, going through all these layers of healing and feeling so vulnerable during this time of sickness we had, and the loss of my mother-in-law, the Lord opened up a layer for me And this is what he revealed to me. So when I accepted the Lord Yeshua, right, many, many years ago, I embraced Yeshua. I embraced Jesus. He set me free. I saw him as friend. I know the Holy Spirit. I know I'm sealed by the Holy Spirit. I know I'm chosen coming to this ministry. I am beloved. I am accepted. All these things. So in my journey, the Lord started giving me all these scriptures of who I was in him. And I think he had to do that first. You know, he had to heal me first before he started revealing big things to me. So I'm justified. I'm forgiven. I'm his righteousness, right? Yeah. I am redeemed. But here's the thing he just revealed to me. Now he wants me to know who he is. So he said to me, you know me as Lord. And I love the Lord. I love to spend time with the Lord. I love to be in the presence of the Lord. And because I've been, you know, again, some pus pockets from my past having to do with my father. And rejection, the Lord showed me, you don't know me as Father. And I'm like, okay. I shared this with Dr. Patricia over the weekend. You know, we prayed about it. And so, this is what he gave me. 2 Corinthians 6:18, and I will be a father to you. And you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Psalms 103:13. As the Father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. And I say that because, you know, my father was, I mean, he was a good provider. He was present. But my father was harsh, and he was distant. And, you know, in one incident, and I'm not going to go through my testimony because it's going to take till tomorrow, but I was pregnant young, and in my culture, that's just not something you do. You know, you don't get pregnant at 15. So my father ignored me completely for 4 years. And so when I say there was a pus pocket that was revealed recently, this hurt and pain, it's the silence. Mm-hmm. Knowing there's a father there, but he's just silent. Mm-hmm. And my brain somehow was making that connection. So when I was like not feeling good and we had all these things happening this year, my brain somehow made, or, you know, I made, my mind made the connection that my father was just silent and different. And so he's just revealed to me this over the weekend, actually.
Mm, amen.
So if that speaks to any of you, amen. Maybe you know, the Lord Almighty as your father, but for me, I think I'm going to get into a very even deeper relationship with my father.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Yeah.
On the bottom of that, just turn it off.
Wow.
Amen.
Yes.
Can you guys see how our image of God can be messed up even when we think we have a great image?
Mm-hmm.
How amazing. You know, I have just tons more. I used to think when I heard people speak for 45 minutes, I thought, what can I say for 45 minutes? And now I have so much more material, but I think at this point in time, I would love to just open the altar and pray. And anyone that would want prayer, has anything been stirred up in you? Has there been things that you thought that things need to be changed, or you want healing, or to know him as Father? That so many things that we just want to open the altar and pray for you before we send you on your way for the weekend. Again, it's been an amazing weekend. We want to thank the hotel for being so generous to us, and we want to thank the pastors that's come from New Mexico, the praise team that's come from New Mexico. We have Pastor Anthony here from San Antonio, Pastors Art and Mary from California that's come to just bless us with their presence. So we've just been so blessed by all of that. Again, people have asked about giving an offering, and we don't charge for these conferences because we believe that we've been given freely, and freely that we need to give. But the giving that you do give to the ministry all goes for things like this. It doesn't go for salaries, no one gets paid. It goes for the ministry. So if you feel led to ever give to the ministry, know that you're furthering the kingdom of God when you give the offering. But with that, I'm going to close in prayer. If you would like to just get up and leave, you're welcome to. If you would like prayer, we're going to open up the altar. But if you stay and you're not getting prayer, would you have reverence for the Holy Spirit? That we don't want you chit-chatting in your seats and making a lot of noise while we're praying. You can go out in the foyer and close those doors if you'd like to fellowship. But we're going to keep this area in a reverence for the Lord while he ministers. Amen. If I can have our praise team come up and just do some background music, or put some background music on while we're ministering. We're going to go ahead and cut off the live stream. We're so glad you all joined us. If you would like to email me, you can email me at patricia@wosow.org. You can send in prayer requests. I would love to pray for you. We also have appointments. I know my schedule's pretty far out, but if you would like a one-on-one appointment, you can always call the office and set an appointment through Pastor Abigail. God bless all of you. Amen. Amen.